Hello everybody and welcome to this collaboration between Talking Mic and Text Mic. This is Factorio There Is No Spoon on default settings with a comprehensive step-by-step guide for casual players, which is downloadable by the way. Wait, what? We already played for 12 seconds before we even got control of our character? That's unacceptable. Let's reload the game. If you like Factorio, you'll probably like Shapes.io. It combines the relaxing parts of Factorio with its own style, which makes this a highly satisfying game. You'll extract basic shapes, then lead them to diverse machines which cut them up, rotate them, paint them in custom mixed colors, put them back together again, and even layer them on top of each other. You'll fulfill increasingly difficult quests which unlock new machinery and diverse upgrades. Follow the link in the description and get yourself a fun new game for only 4 bucks and support my channel at the same time. So the first thing we do is press tab to skip the cutscene and save 12 seconds. Next press alt and that will reveal the 8 iron plates which are hidden in the wreckage. You can collect these iron plates like you do from chests, so you don't need to mine up the wreckage. Next, we mine exactly one coal rock, and then we'll head over to the iron patch. At the iron patch, we will place 2 burner miners and 2 furnaces. We will put 12 coal in every burner miner and 6 coal in every furnace. And after that, we will never refill them again. So we will need to wait until one iron plate has smelted to craft the second burner miner. And if I was a real pro, I would have already crafted 3 iron gears while I was walking down here. Again, put 12 coal into the Wait a minute, they didn't give me enough coal? What kind of a guide is this? Anyway, just put all of the coal you have in there, it's not a problem. Head back out and mine 8 or so coal rocks and also chop down a few trees. On the way back, turn all of that stone into a glorious wall for our furnaces. Turn it all into furnaces. Who was that guy? Anyway, our goal is to expand to 12 burner miners on iron, 12 burner miners on coal and 4 burner miners on copper. Craft the miners one by one, so you don't need to wait on a bunch of intermediates to complete. Again, 6 coal per furnace and 12 coal per miner. And refills are not included in the price. Now, if your map does not contain so many coal rocks like mine, then you need to put 2 to 4 burner miners on coal and stone early on. On maps without any coal rocks, just reroll. What are you doing? But if you really need to play it, you can refer to the Excel document where you will find an alternative build order for this situation. After we have 12 burner miners on the iron patch, the next goal is to get 12 burner miners on the coal patch. If at any point during the early game you need to wait for something, just cut down a couple of trees. You will need the wood anyway to make power poles. Place the burner miners on the coal into a circle, so they feed into each other. You can kickstart the miners by inserting 1 coal into each miner. After we've put 12 burner miners on the coal patch, or 14 if you cannot count like me, it's time to head over to the copper patch. After we set up 4 burner miners on the copper patch, the burner stage of the game is now complete. We are 6 to 8 minutes into the game. Now we collect all resources from the furnaces, so we can craft the stuff for the early power plant. You will need 1 offshore pump, 6 boilers with 6 steam engines, 1 underground pipe, 10 normal pipes to connect water to the desired location, a bunch of power poles and finally 1 lab and 10 red science packs. Finally, we want to take at least 300 coal so we can fill the 6 boilers. Try to build a power plant in a location where you can fit 20 boilers next to each other, so it's easy to expand the power plant later. Take the power lines all the way back to your ore patches. Don't build a lab at the power plant, especially if it's far away. Place the labs, insert the science packs and research automation. It is time to switch to electric miners. burner miners generate over 2 times more pollution compared to electric miners, even if you take into account the pollution generated by boilers to make power. This is important because we want our pollution cloud to grow as slowly as possible, because once pollution reaches enemy nests, attack will start. Start by putting 10 electric miners on the iron. For now, each miner outputs directly into a furnace, and each furnace will get 25 coal. After we have 10 miners on iron, we will first work on automating our research. For this we need 4 assembly machines, 4 inserters and 1 extra lab. Fill the setup with 100 iron in each gearwheel assembler and 50 copper in each red science assembler. That will give us 100 science packs to work with. Now that red science is sort of automated, we are going to put electric miners on all of our other resources. 2 miners on copper, again with furnaces with 25 coal each. 4 miners onto coal directly into chests, and don't forget to deconstruct those stinky burners. 't forget, if you need a moment to think about what to do next, you can always pause the game by opening the technology screen. The last resource patch which need miners is stone. 2 miners directly into a chest will do. Now all of our basic resources are being produced. So before we expand any further, we will first start our personal army of assembling machines. Having access to just these basic intermediates will make it a lot faster to craft miners, assembly machines and all other stuff you need for your base. But be sure to not spend all of your plates into intermediates, because all of the stuff you need to build your base consumes a lot of iron plates as well, and copper plates are needed to produce red science packs. So, our next goal is to expand to 20 miners on iron and 6 miners on copper. Again, put 25 coal in each new furnace. After you have 20 miners on iron and 6 miners on copper, refill the first 10 iron miners with 25 coal each. Now we'll prepare to go on a little trip, but first we need to refill the science setup. Put 50 copper and 50 iron gears in each red science assembler. Now that we have iron gears in our inventory, the iron gear assemblers are no longer needed, but make sure to transfer the iron gears to the red science assemblers. Now we can deconstruct these and add them to our personal assembly area. 4 assembly machines for iron gears and 1 for copper wires. Regularly check if the pollution cloud is already reaching enemy nests. If you still have time, like me in this video, we can first expand the power plant and place some radars. If you don't have time anymore, just refill the boilers with 300 coal and start collecting fish from the lake. In that case, you'll need to expand the power plant and place the radars when you return from the war. In my case, I'll expand the power plant first, so I'll take 1000 coal and craft 14 boilers and steam engines. At this point, craft 8 radars. You will need them to keep your pollution cloud visible. You will place 4 at the power plant and 4 at our base. Don't forget to fill your boilers with all the coal you have. Now go ahead and take a well-deserved fishing holiday. If that's not relaxing enough, just deconstruct the fish so they stop moving around. After you've collected 60 fish, don't forget to place the 4 radars. Now we prepare for war. Craft an armor, some weapons and some ammunition. We want the base to keep producing while we're away, so as a final preparation, empty all furnaces and refill signs. And don't forget to place the 4 radars. While you're away, you can handcraft a lot of stuff and organize your hotbar a little bit. First, craft 6 miners, 20 burner inserters and a lot of belts, so we can automate coal delivery to the power plant upon returning. No chiefication. The combat round in this playthrough was straightforward, uneventful and boring, so I borrowed a nicely edited combat round for my first playthrough instead. Well, at least that was the idea. I forgot to place the 4 raiders at the base, and that may or may not lead to problems in the future. Upon returning to the base, first empty all furnaces again, and refill the intermediate assembly machines. Now it is time for our first real automation project, supplying the power plant with coal. Deconstruct the coal chests and expand to 10 coal miners. Here you can see, because I forgot to place my radars, the pollution cloud is now expanding off the visible map. This means there could be enemies gathering for an attack as we speak. Lay a belt to your power plant and place the 20 burner inserters. Burner inserters prevent a brownout from turning into a blackout, because they'll keep working at full speed even if your factory doesn't produce enough power. While you are out here, craft 10 more assembly machines and 2 labs. If, after fighting the enemies, you are low on fish, you could grab a couple more from the lake. Now, triple your personal assembly machines. So, 12 for iron gears and 3 for copper wire. Add the 2 labs to the sign setup and refill the red science assemblers. Give all of the furnaces a refill with 25 coal, except for the 10 furnaces you refilled earlier, they still have plenty. Craft 4 miners with 4 inserters and 2 chests. It is time to start focusing on the smelting area. Pick up all the stone and make about 150 stone furnaces. Put any surplus stone back in the chest. We are already preparing to upgrade the steel furnaces, even though we haven't started the smelting area yet. To do that, we need stone bricks, so set up 4 miners outputting in 4 furnaces, and let the 4 furnaces output into chests. Fill the furnaces with 50 coal each. The other ingredient we need is steel. We will set up automated steel production soon, but we will kickstart the process by setting up 12 temporary furnaces here. We'll make one final expansion to our personal assembly machine army. Craft 15 more assembly machines and possibly relocate them to a more suitable area. At this stage we'll add green circuits and belts to the recipes. You can safely turn all of your copper into copper wire. At this stage of the game it's only required for circuits. Raw iron plates, however, are required for most of the stuff you'll need to build your base, so make sure you don't turn all of your iron plates into something else. Now we're going to find a suitable location for our furnace area. We will need a big open area, preferably not too far from our resource patches. There should be no cliffs and not too many trees. A furnace area consists of 48 furnaces, 24 on each side. You will need 4 identical furnace arrays. Every array will have 2 input belts down the middle and an output belt on either side. Even without blueprints or bots, you can still use the copy-paste function. It's a great planning tool. You will still need to build everything yourself though. Lay out 4 of these furnace arrays side by side. And yes indeed, these are all the furnaces we will need for the entire game. Split the coal belt and take it to the furnace area. To start off, we'll use 1 yellow belt, with coal on one side and ore on the other side. This is a way you can split off the coal and have ore join on the other side. Make sure to keep your personal assembling machines running. You will need a lot of belts and green circuits, because we're going to need a lot of inserters for our furnace area, and soon we're going to need more miners and assembly machines as well. It is time to actually set up the furnaces now. Half a yellow belt of ore can support 24 stone furnaces, so for now we'll only use half of the length of our furnace array, 12 furnaces on either side. Loop the belt around to the other side. We will not use long-handed inserters yet until we have steel power poles. I like to use this specific furnace setup with groups of 3 inserters, mostly because it gives good confirmation if everything is set up right, it's easy to identify the halfway point and it allows for easy upgrading later. But go ahead and use any furnace setup you are used to. First we set up the iron furnaces, because that's the resource we need the most right now. For the iron mine I like to use underground belts with power poles in the middle. This allows you to place the miners back to back, allowing for more miners on the ore patch. If you set up your first iron miners like mine, you can now just flip them around. My main bus is going to the left and I like to have copper on the bottom of my bus. That means the first furnace array is meant for copper. It's also easier to manage iron and steel production if both iron furnace arrays are next to each other. Now that the iron production is taken care of, we will set up an identical 24 furnace array for the copper. I didn't set up my copper miners as smart as my iron miners, so I will need to deconstruct the furnaces here. Another pro tip, if you do something fancy schmancy, always check if it works. Finally, connect your copper ore belt to the furnace array and we have finished our first smelting automation. Somewhere around this point, all red science except the weapon upgrades should be finished. At this point, refill the science assemblers one last time, so we can research both weapon upgrades. Collect 1200 iron and refill the steel furnaces. Make sure you have a stack of power poles and all the belts you need to set up the mining area, then craft 50 miners. First, expand the miners on the coal field until you have 20 coal miners. and then double the iron miners so you have 40 iron miners. The copper mining expansion will have to wait, because first we need to set up the second iron furnace array. One full iron ore belt can supply two half iron ore belts, so you can split your iron ore belt into two. After the second iron furnace array is set up, use it to feed 12 steel furnaces. For now, we'll use some quick and dirty automation. Later, we'll do it right and lead a proper iron belt around to it. After this is done, you no longer need to refill the temporary steel furnaces. You can deconstruct them once they are done. Note that we will usually use the second iron array exclusively to produce steel, but in times of need it can help out with the iron plate production as well. We have prioritized iron production because it's needed to construct much of our base, but now that it's up and running, we can focus on expanding copper. Expand to 20 copper miners. Like I mentioned before, the temporary steel furnaces can be deconstructed now. Check the map occasionally and keep track of your pollution cloud and newly discovered nests. Here, I finally find out I forgot to place the 4 radars earlier. The pollution is now spreading off the visible map, but pollution can still generate new map chunks, including enemy nests, and that means I have no idea about how close I am to getting attacked. Anyway, if you see in your game that pollution is about to reach enemy nests, go and take them out with a preemptive strike. We have significantly increased our production since the early game. So make sure you keep feeding your assembly machines, and don't let all that iron and copper sit idly in the furnaces. We are now almost ready to start the main boss, so it's time to make output belts for our furnaces. Make sure you extend the belts all the way beyond the future furnace expansion. As you see, we have one copper belt, one iron belt, and one belt which can be divided between iron and steel as needed. And yes, that's really enough for the entire game. We're trying to complete the game in 6-8 hours, not in 2. The main reason I wanted to make this video is to showcase that you don't need godlike memorization or tile perfect placement to get this achievement. You can even get attacked like a total noob and you will still be able to make the achievement. I checked the pollution tab, which indeed confirms that biter spawners have started to absorb pollution. But because I forgot to place the radars, I don't have an idea where exactly they are coming from. It does seem like they are coming from somewhere in the south though. We have to go check it out immediately though, because once they start attacking, they won't stop. Hey, what are you doing? I said immediately. But yeah, once you have a few stacks of circuits, gears and lots of belts, you can deconstruct the personal assembly machines. But right now, you would think we have more urgent matters to deal with. Now you can watch me go in overconfident, while low on ammo, low on fish, and I've even forgotten to craft a heavy armor. Ah, yeah. So as the pollution tab confirms, there are no more enemy nests consuming pollution. So this nest was indeed the source of the attacks. We can now put our light armor away into our legacy chest and prepare to start work on the main boss. So the first thing we do is join both sides of the output belts together. The copper line is pretty straightforward, but pay special attention to the iron line. The second iron array should only function as a helper, so we want to set priority on the first iron line. To do that, we place a priority splitter with input priority on the first iron line. That means that iron from the second array is accepted through only if more iron is needed than the first iron line can provide. Any surplus iron is then automatically deviated to the steel furnace array. Keep at least a 4 assembly machine wide space between the furnace outputs and the bottom of your main bus. You will need that space later to set up some buffer chests and for the inevitable belt spaghetti. For the main bus, we're going to need a whole bunch of fast inserters and some long-handed inserters. You should already have 30 assembly machines to start off with. If not, go and deconstruct your personal assembly machine area now. For the sake of YouTube, I also craft a bunch of lights and I will try to remember to place them. The very start of the bus will have two iron belts coming in. As we have only one dedicated iron line, that means we have to keep an eye on the second iron line. Sometimes we'll need lots of iron and sometimes the complete second iron line will need to go to the steel line. To start off, split the first iron line and lead it to 8 iron gear assemblers. Below the assemblers, set up a splitter with a buffer chest. For the rest of the game, we can manually manage output priority as needed at the time. To the chest for personal use, to the main bus, or a 50-50 split between the chest and the main bus. Next, take the second iron belt and split it off to the green circuits area. Zing! By using this strategy to split off the iron, we ensure a balanced resource flow to the important intermediates of iron gears and green circuits, as well as enough iron flowing down the belt for later use on the main bus. In case you have never heard of Factorio before, this is probably the most famous ratio known in the game. 3 copper wire assemblers to 2 green circuit assemblers. Because copper wire assemblers produce 2 copper wire from 1 copper plate, each one needs 2 output inserters to keep up. Again, you... Wait a second. Hey dude, I'm trying to explain a point here, but I can't see anything. Maybe you can play some of the slides you promised us earlier. Yeah, that's better. Thank you very much. Anyway, the buffer chests have multiple functions. Not only do they supply us with intermediates which we use to craft stuff for our base, it also helps us late game, when we can hand distribute these buffered resources to the areas that need it most. Great, we have built 2 green circuit assemblers. Now, quadruple that setup so we have 8 of them. We have lots of iron and copper production which isn't doing anything, so this is a great time to stock up on green circuits and iron gears. I like to make a double wide setup. If you don't, make sure you keep space to double this setup once more later in the game. After the iron split off for gear wheels and green circuits, we can now join the 2 iron belts for the remainder of the bus. The foundations of the main bus are now complete and we can start to set up red and green signs. So next, set up 5 red science assemblers and 6 green science assemblers. Ultimately, our setup will produce 45 science per minute. This may seem low, but it's more than enough for our goals. Remember, we're trying to beat the game in 6 to 8 hours, not in 2 hours like a world-class speedrunner. And unless you are one of them, 45 science per minute will research stuff faster than you can keep up with. This is how you split off multiple resources from a cramped bus. Feel free to use a wider bus with more space in between the belts if this is not your cup of tea. But if you're only building on one side of the bus, this shouldn't be too difficult. The red science is producing already, so now we can shift over to the green science. And now the top secret reason I wanted copper on the bottom of the bus will be revealed. That's right. We can pull all of the stuff for the Green Science ingredients straight off the bus. And there's no need to do any belt spaghetti shenanigans. Two long-handed inserters work at the same speed as one fast inserter, so we double them up to keep our machinery working at full speed. I once claimed I would not build a mall. I lied. Here is my mall. If you put three output inserters to the belt and only one in the chest, that ensures that 75% of all resources will go towards Green Science. If they do not alternate outputs, some of the inserters are in a different map chunk. Enable Show Tile Grid when paused in the settings, then you can pause the game and see the chunk borders. Anytime you want to use alternating output inserters to balance something, all of the output inserters need to be in the same chunk for it to work. As an alternative strategy, you can just output from the mall chests back onto the belt. All of the red signs should be finished by now. Make sure you have gears and circuits on you, and then make 26 laps for 30 in total. Deconstruct the 4 laps from the starting area. Before you set up the laps, first take all the steel from the furnaces and put it in a chest. Put 1500 steel in total if you have it. Now we can finally set up the labs and start our Green Science research. Make sure you set up the labs in a way so they can grab from 3 input belts. Use direct input from belts, don't feed science from lab to lab. This causes a small amount of science to be lost between game ticks, every time an inserter moves science packs between labs. This will be increasingly important later in the game because we will only produce a limited amount of the expensive late game science packs. In this playthrough I chose a setup which allows 2 lanes down the middle, while the late game science packs will go on a belt around the outside. And so begins the second phase of our game, the Green Tech era.